Peyton Manning got a chance to study the Jets' defense firsthand just 4 weeks ago. When Peyton sees a team for the second time in a season, he usually puts up great numbers. Over the last 3 years, that's happened 8 times, and in those games, he completed 69% of his passes and threw for an average of just over 300 yards per game. He also threw for 21 touchdowns and 4 interceptions. Chances are pretty good that this week, he'll have to do it without much help from his running game.
10 games in the NHL Monday. The Leafs in Music City for just the 3rd time in franchise history, trying to snap a 5-game road losing slide. Couldn't have asked for a better start. Nicholas Hagman with his first goal in 12 games. Toronto 10-2-2 when they strike first.
In New Orleans, we'll get a chance to see the 2 highest-scoring teams in the NFL from this past season go head-to-head. The Saints averaged 32 points per game, while the Vikings averaged 29. The last time the highest-scoring teams faced each other in the NFC Championship game was 1994. That game saw the 49ers and Cowboys combine for a total 66 points.
NFL news from the Monday after the wild card games. We'll get to teams still playing in a second. But first to Seattle and the worst-kept secret in the Northwest. The Seahawks confirmed that Pete Carroll will be their head coach. Press conference unveiling to come on Tuesday. Carroll is more known for the college dynasty he built with USC as opposed to his 4 seasons as an NFL head coach with the Jets and Pats in the 90s. In a statement, Carroll called his 9 years at USC the best years of my coaching life. Lots of work to do. They still need to hire a GM. In Toronto, this is Julie Stewart-Binks for The Score. American football doesn't have a large following in the United Kingdom, but a local team, the London Blitz, is working on changing that. We sat down with head coach Mark Moss to find out more about the future of American football in London. This Sunday, the big gun run's happening. Looks like it's going to be a pretty fun event, and hopefully the weather's going to be good too. So we'll be learning more about that in just a few minutes.
Now this is going to be benefiting the Easter Seals Ontario, right? So this is a really beneficial event that's going to be raising some much needed funds here in the Kingston area. What I love about this run is it's not just for runners, it's for really anyone, even walkers, if you want to come on out.
Definitely, and the course is very accessible. So, you know, really anyone who wants to come out can do it and should be a good time. For years, golf has been thought of as a typical gentleman's game, but here at Expertise, Donna Dunbar is showing everyone what the ladies can do. Thanks very much for being with us here today, Donna.
Thank you for having me.
So tell us, how did you get started as a golf pro? I'm at the Invista Center where some firefighters are preparing for the upcoming FireFit Challenge that is happening this weekend here at the Invista Center. Today I'm joined by Dale McRoberts, who is the FireFit president. Thanks very much for being with us here today.
It's great to be here. It's a good weekend for it.
Welcome back to Newswatch at 5:30. We're here in the Frontenac's dressing room with athletic trainer Craig Belfer. Now, many people know that the Frontenac's train very hard during the season for all of their many games, but when the season's over, they don't just go home, you know, clock some patio time. They're in the gym, they're working hard, and today we're going to learn more about that. Tried that body drag recently. I definitely can't do it, and it just makes you think, what kind of training is involved?
Good, well, good luck today in your squash games, and why don't we hit a couple more rallies before we end?
Sounds good.
Good to hear. Well, okay, looks like we've got a net behind us. You guys are holding sticks and a ball. Why don't you guys teach me how to cradle and perhaps pass using a lacrosse stick? Perfect. Sound good?
Right.
Okay.
So let's first work on the basic cradle. What you're going to do is you're going to lift the stick up a little bit more at an angle.
Yeah.
Ruthie's going to show it to you.
Ahead.
Just like that, yeah. And then you're going to roll it sort of in your hand.
Okay.
Yeah, perfect. That was a great toss.
And I just have my coaching kid, cradle, and...
Oh!
Well, unfortunately, I'm not a good lacrosse player, but it looks like these girls are holding up the team very well. And this is Julie Stewart-Binks for Queens TV signing off, wishing you guys a great rest of the season.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I mean, historically, the Yankees definitely prevail, but right now, last 5 years, especially agreeing with you, and even it just shows with their fans, like Fenway Park's been sold out for, what, the last, like since 2003, every game. But I'm going to have to say the Yankees, they do have this sort of overwhelming image, and when you think of baseball, the Yankees tend to come to mind.
This past weekend, success looked bleak for not only the men's hockey team, but also the women's hockey team. On Friday, January 16th, the Gales faced the York Lions in a disappointing 6-1 loss. On Saturday, January 17th, the Gales lost once again to the York Lions, this time 4-1. In a span of 24 hours, the Gales lost twice to the York Lions in a move that Harold Parsons, coach of the women's hockey team, told the Queen's Journal he could not explain.
Right, now, as you're saying, this is the last home game you guys have here, and especially for you and the other five graduating students on the team, what's the mood like in the dressing room?
So, Billy, you know, this game's been going pretty well for you. 2 goals this game, last game you got 3 points. What's going on? You haven't been doing this all season. Finally, you bring it out. Tell me, where's the momentum coming from?
I mean, I don't know. I thought I was playing pretty hard all season. I just didn't seem to be getting any breaks.
This is Julie Stewart-Binks for TV Kojiko.